Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners is now in session. I'd like to call on Commissioner Sutton to lead us in the invocation and pledge of allegiance.
We can have a moment, please. My Heavenly Father, thank you for a beautiful morning. Be with us today as we conduct the county's business. Be with us in our professional lives. Be with us in our personal lives. Dear Lord, as we wake up, as I woke up this morning and for the past few days, man's atrocity to man worldwide is at a level I have never witnessed. It can only, I'm afraid it will get worse if somehow mankind does not get a spirit in his heart and her heart that we cannot continue to be a civilized planet with what we are now seeing. Matthew 5:5, New Testament, it is written that on the Sermon on the Mount, that there were several beatitudes of what man could inherit if he would have only in his heart the spirit that he needs to have. Matthew 5:5 says, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Help us all, if we are in the spirit, to follow such teachings. Help us all to check what level of inheritance that we think we want and try to analyze what level of inheritance that we think we have and adjust our lives accordingly. Be with our military worldwide as we know what the enemy wants to do to the greatest country in the world. Please help all of mankind. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Tim. It's time for our public comment session. Mr. Cox.
How y'all doing today?
Good.
I agree with what you said in that prayer, Tim.
Appreciate that, Tony.
I do. But, you know, a lot of the bad has got to be exposed. And not only exposed, there's got to be accountability. You know, I was so pleased at the last commissioners meeting in this room when I found out that Jason Martin was leaving. Hopefully he'll never be hired back in this county and he'll never have another victim in this county. We got a few more in this county that need to be gone just like Jason Martin. You know, if you look around, we've got all these checks and balances in this country. I went over there to the hearing for the sheriff on Friday. And it was amazing to me. You know, I know back in 2004 that them people over there was liars. And they showed last Friday that they're still liars, accusing the sheriff of things. And the judge calling them out on their lies and turn around and keep on talking about the lies. It's amazing to me, amazing. Our system is set up, and that's one of the main problems in the United States of America is our system is set up against us, the people. Against us. Government, the judge is calling the DOJ government. Well, I think everybody involved is government. But to me, that shows a bias. He should be calling them DOJ. But they're talking about constitutional rights violations, just like constitutional rights violations in this room against Deborah Prince, against me, and against others. Is the DOJ going to jump in there and take up the sheriff's calls for them, the DOJ, Civil Rights Division, for violating his constitutional rights? You know, it's a fine line and it's hard to walk it. But it's easy. It's clear. You can play word games, but guess what? Them word games, they come back and get you. They say the truth will set you free. One of the things the judge said over there was, settle this matter, settle it. And I say the same thing in the case of Deborah Prince and me. Settle it. It ain't going nowhere. All it's doing is keeping us all in the same rut. I've heard about, Ben's, he's here today, I've heard about the Chamber of No Commerce. I can't believe that the Chamber of Commerce, who's supposed to help us with jobs, would even allow, back in 2006 when these ordinances was done, how you can come in with ordinances that want to say, we don't want these industries. 3 minutes just ain't enough. We need five. I'm a citizen.
Thank you, Tony.
I'm supposed to be the boss.
Any response from Commissioner? The agenda is, are there anything we need to add to the agenda, Mr. Manager?
No, sir. Mr. Chairman, I do want to talk to Commissioner Massey. She's still having problems with her knee, and that's why she's not here today. So she wanted me to give you her apologies, and you know, we need to keep her in our thoughts as she's been struggling with that knee.
Yeah, she was in a lot of pain at the last meeting.
Yes, sir.
The agenda, any commissioner want to remove anything from this consent agenda? If not, do I have a motion to approve the agenda, which includes the consent agenda?
So
motion,
moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye. Mr. Robert Hilton, would you please come forward, please? Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Hilton is here representing our military heroes who were awarded Purple Hearts. And the board has a proclamation that I'd like to read to Mr. Hilton at this time. Proclamation in honor of the Military Order of the Purple Heart, whereas the Purple Heart is the oldest military decoration still in present use and was initially created by General George Washington in 1782 as the badge of military merit. And whereas the Purple Heart was the first American service award made available to the common soldier and is specifically awarded to those members of the United States Armed Services who have been wounded or killed in combat with a declared enemy of the United States. And whereas the mission of the Military Order of the Purple Heart, chartered by an act of Congress, is to foster an environment of goodwill among the combat wounded veteran members and their families, to promote patriotism, to support related legislative initiatives, and most importantly, to make sure we never forget the sacrifices made by those so decorated. And whereas there have been many former Alamance County residents who made the ultimate sacrifice in giving their lives in the cause of freedom, and the numerous combat wounded veterans who currently reside in Alamance County, and as Purple Heart awardees who contribute to their community in countless ways. And whereas Alamance County, North Carolina, pursuant to a request by Chapter 634 of the Military Order of the Purple Heart, wishes to pledge its strong support for this noble organization and for those who put their lives at risk in service of their country and their fellow citizens. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed and resolved that Alamance County, North Carolina, by the affirmative action declaration of its Board of County Commissioners, does hereby bestow honor and gratitude upon the members of the Military Order of the Purple Heart and proudly supports the recognition of Alamance County as a Purple Heart County in the state of North Carolina. Mr. Hilton, this is for you and your organization. Thank you, sir. And you certainly have the floor.
Thank you. This is, some of you already know, this is the way Purple Heart is recognizing not only the veterans in Alamance County, but throughout the state of North Carolina. More especially those that didn't make it back that got the Purple Heart. But we've now recognized 74 counties in the state have recognized Purple Heart as Purple Heart counties. We're going to hit all 100.
Good.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. My question, is this Mac coming in there? I'm sorry, Mac.
It's awful hard to follow that.
Thank you for letting me be here this morning. I am here to ask you folks to consider setting a date for a public hearing. We've had a request for incentives from a local company that wants to expand. The name of the company is CS Carolina. They would like to proceed with the process of the incentives procedure with a public hearing for, I believe it's July 21st.
Yes.
Is that correct?
That's our next scheduled meeting.
That's your next scheduled meeting, July 21st. So at this point in time, I would simply ask for the setting of the date for July 21st.
Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Mac.
Thank you very much. See you on the 21st.
Yes, sir. There's one item that is not on the agenda that I'd like to bring up at this time. Pam, would you come forward, please? Pam Thompson, member of the Alamance, or the Burlington Alamance School System. She's a board member. Recently, the superintendent of schools sent us a letter asking for a letter of support for a grant that the school system is seeking about cyberbullying, which I think all parents and all citizens, and I see the sheriff shaking his head, so it has become a serious problem. And Pam, we have that letter. If you would deliver it to the superintendent, please, we certainly would appreciate it, and we certainly do support your cause and hope that you get that grant.
Well, this is Barbara Carlton. She's our violence prevention specialist. She's the head of this committee that we're working on, and I want to also just, she's amazing. She's a gift to all of our students, and Dr. Todd Thorpe, one of our assistant superintendents over student services, is a real leader in this too, with our school counselors, our social workers, and our school nurses. And I just want to thank you for not even blinking your eye to do this. This is amazing. Every police chief in our county signed a letter of support. So did our sheriff, and Patrick Nadolski did too, because this is a crime, and we see that at every level, and we cannot tolerate in our school systems, nor can any child ever come to school with fear of who's waiting on them at the end of the hall. And we're working together, our board and your board, because this is child-centered, and we're always going to keep the main thing the main thing. And thank you, gentlemen, for doing this. This is big. And just pray that we get this, because it's K through 12, and we can really kick bullying's butt, because that's what it deserves. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pam, and good luck. Cindy Brady, Fatality Review Team. Cindy, good morning.
Good morning.
So I'm here today to request that the Board of Commissioners appoint a couple of folks to a Fatality Review Team. So the Family Justice Center has been involved in a lot of things lately. The Electronic Protective Order System has improved victim follow-through. It's decreased the time it takes to do protective orders. The Volunteer Court Navigator Program has decreased dismissals. So all this has created a lot of attention from surrounding counties. We've had an international delegation come here to visit. And as a result of that, Mecklenburg County was asking for a revision of the Fatality Review Team legislation and called and asked if we would like to be included in that as a county to conduct fatality review. So this is very much like the current child fatality review legislation that currently has taken place in our county for years, and it's simply going back and reviewing fatalities to see if anything could have been done differently, what could be done differently, and to implement those measures. So as part of this legislation, the Board of Commissioners is charged with designating a lead agency that has experience working with victims of domestic violence and a representative from an institution of higher learning. And what I'm asking is that the Family Justice Center be designated as the lead agency, and that Sandra Reed from Elon University be appointed the person from an institution of higher learning. You also have the responsibility of appointing two community members who have experience with domestic violence. And I'm asking that you postpone that until we actually get the team together. We haven't had a fatality since 2010 to review. So right now it's a matter of getting the team together, laying out the bylaws, the procedure, and the process. And I have a letter of support from my advisory board.
Okay, and what are you asking for, Cindy?
I'm asking for you to appoint the lead agency for the Fatality Review Team, the Family Justice Center, and to appoint the member from an institution of higher learning, specifically Sandra Reed, who's been involved with us over the past couple of years doing studies and so and helping us figure out the needs of the community as it relates to domestic violence. Because the legislature asks that you appoint people who have had experience.
Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second. Any discussion?
Yes. These guys do a wonderful job. As an attorney, having practiced for 40 years, I really appreciate the years that you've been in operation. You've made a big difference. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
Any other thing? All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Cindy.
Man, don't leave. I got to tell you something before you leave. Can I go ahead and do this? She's getting ready to go.
Yeah, go ahead.
This wasn't cyberbullying, but it was about bullying. I was at a class at Northern Guilford teaching a class up there. Sorry to do this this way. I didn't want you to leave. Went outside to watch kids leave, parents coming up to pick them up, you know, and I didn't want to leave people out there. A little girl standing over the right. And she looked at me, and I could tell she was wanting to ask me something. And I said, "Now, what is it?" She said, "Well, I wanted to ask you something, but I don't believe I will." I said, "Go ahead." I mean, I could tell it was innocent. And she said, "I can tell you're a man of great faith." And I said, "Why? You know, what makes you?" I said, "I hope so, but what makes you say that?" She said, "It's the way you are in class." And she started talking about being bullied. You know, you're talking about cyberbullying, and it works in a lot of ways. And she said, "People talk about me being ugly and her being ugly." I said, "Well, they must be blind." And she'd actually gone into a hospital with depression and so forth. Just the sweetest thing you've ever seen. People just gave her a hard time. And I looked at her and I said, "Now here I am, 60. I was 62 then, I guess." And I said, "Have you ever heard of, seen Taylor Swift's video of Mean?" And her mouth dropped wide open, like, "How would you know about that video?" And I told her, I said, "Look, I watch country music videos every morning, or used to at that time, and I actually tape them. I show them in class if I think they can be emotional, an emotional help for them." And I said, "You know what that video shows?" And she said, "Yeah." And it's talking about how the boy that was picked on a lot winds up getting a good-looking girlfriend. You know, the girl that was picked on and wasn't allowed to sit down with her classmates to eat lunch, and she had to go in a bathroom stall and sit down to eat her lunch. That's what the video shows. She winds up being their boss and so forth and so on. And but the video is called Mean, M-E-A-N. And she looked at me and she said, her and her mother thought that ought to be their theme song. And I want to tell you, it's one of the best experiences I've ever had with a student. Her mother told me, she said, "You've done more for her than the doctors have." But bullying is a big
problem in our schools, everywhere, frankly. But not only cyberbullying, but personal. And I talk about it in class. I tell my students, you know, if you see somebody bullying, get involved, stop it. Be a part of the solution, not part of the problem. But, you know, it's easy to bully people when, you know, you don't have much going for yourself. And I think that happens a lot. And I feel sorry for kids that are bullied. And I just had to say it to you before you left.
So I'm just glad the Lord put you in that child's path that day.
It's the best thing ever happened to me. It's the best thing that's ever happened to me. Just wish it paid better, but I don't do it for the money, I'll assure you. I'd do it for nothing.
Thank you.
Take care. Good luck with that. I'm sorry.
All right, thank you, Tim. County attorney.
Good morning, Chairman.
Good morning.
Board members, I bring before you a proposal to purchase the property at 600 North Main Street, 217 College Street, and 779 Woody Drive. And we received a proposal from Peak, cash price $3.9 million. The deal involves conveying all of the property to Peak and then a reconveyance of the Woody Drive property after it's been cleared and the new building built. And the reason we had to do that is because you cannot transfer the 120 nursing home beds unless you own the property or lease the property. So, but that's the offer presented to you today. If the board should decide to go forward, we'll publish this offer in the newspaper in accordance with 168-269. 10 days will run, and if there are any competing offers, we'll bring that before you. And if there are not, then we will bring the original offer back, and at any time the board can reject any or all offers. Be glad to try and answer any questions you have.
What is the staff's recommendation, Pat?
Well, I've run over these numbers with our finance director, and he says they look good. the cash price we were shooting for was $3.6 million, but I asked for $3.9 and they agreed to that. The demolition costs for that Woody Drive property estimated about $150,000 to $175,000. That doesn't include the asbestos abatement. And we have an underground diesel tank over there as well. So there may be some environmental costs, may not be. So it looks like a very good offer for the county. It's just up to the board to decide if you want to consider it.
Will they take care of the environmental issues if there are any?
We had a tank replaced several years ago, and they did the testing then to close out that other tank and didn't find any problems. But this tank's been in the ground for some time, and it's a 300-gallon tank, so you never know. It might have a small problem. It might not be so small.
I guess the question is, who would cover the cost if there is an issue?
Well, he is to demolish it and leave the property vacant under the agreement.
Including the environmental issue.
Any other comments?
No. Guys, sounds like a good deal to me.
We're not financing in this one. I think it's a much, much better offer than we had before.
Oh, I agree.
Mr. Albright, with the $3.9 million plus the $175,000, that's over $4 million in consideration.
Yes.
Appreciate the job you did.
Well, thank you. And we will publish this notice in the newspaper on Thursday.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Third. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Ms. Hager, Assistant County Manager.
We put it in the Times News.
I'm going to dim the lights so you can see some of the pictures. The folks here at the fence can see them all. Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners.
Good morning.
I'm here this morning to give you a report and an update on the county's performance management, performance-based budgeting program. I'm not going to be asking for any specific action from the board. This is to tell you how fiscal year 2012-13 panned out. If y'all remember, back in 2011-12 fiscal year, the county initiated a test program for performance management. We had six departments that year volunteer to, there wasn't any funding tracking or funding savings attached to that year. It was only goals, but six departments that set goals, went through that fiscal year, monitoring their goals, those kind of things. This was based on some research that I believe Mr. Sutton and some county management staff had done, looked at particularly Davidson County as a model. They have this program there. After that 11-12 year, the commissioners approved, you have a copy of the approved policy there before you. In April of 2012, the commissioners approved a policy based on the Davidson County model. There are some deviations from it, but it's primarily based on how Davidson County runs their program. And then for fiscal year 12-13, county departments managed under this program. So I'm going to go through a little bit of this information this morning. There basically are two tiers to the county's existing performance management program. And again, you have a copy of this report before you. It's the spiral bound of it. If you want to look on yours, if it's easier for you to see. Departments can pick to either be goal-setting departments or non-goal-setting. That means everybody, every single county government department, this only pertains to county government, not to any outside agencies this program does. Every county department is involved in it from a savings perspective. They're all involved in the savings part of the plan. But under current policy, they can choose to be goal setting or not. If they choose to be goal setting, there are some advantages to that. They retain savings at a higher rate. If they have any savings at the end of the year, they are able to retain those savings at a higher percentage than they would if they didn't set goals. And also, there is some incentive for the departments to set goals in that one of the approved expenditures of savings is to give bonuses to employees of the department. If the department chooses to set goals, they are able to give a higher bonus than a department that did not set goals, that only participated in the savings part of the program. Now, according to the policy that you have, it's been approved by the commissioners, savings department's experience can be used for a few things, including new equipment for the department, vehicles, capital improvements put toward buildings, or, as I mentioned, employee bonuses. Now, in 2012-13, this is the year this report pertains to, every department, every county government department chose to be a goal-setting department. I believe the incentive for them was, you know, they're concerned about their employees. They wanted to put themselves in the position where if they were able to have savings, they would be able to give the maximum amount of bonus to their employees. That's a real incentive. That leads me to believe that this program was considered throughout the fiscal year. So one thing I do want to speak to you while I'm on this page, if you'll notice on the right-hand column where it says how department savings are calculated. So you got two parts to the program. One, department set goals. They track those goals throughout the fiscal year. Two, they try to save money. And they try to save money every year, but they try to save money under this program. The difference is, with this program in effect, they're able to retain for their own uses instead of the money just going to general fund if they save it. They get to keep some of it. Well, this was the first year that we've tried to calculate their savings. And we put together some information here about how we did that, because we wanted you to understand. So the department has budgeted money at the start of the year, X number of dollars. By budgeting them that money and approving it, you're giving them the authority to spend all the money that they're budgeted for certain deliverables. So their savings, their unspent funds, are finalized by the county audit. When the county gets the audit, that is the official statement of how much money each department had left. So we have to wait for the audit to come in to make sure we're looking at the right dollar amount. Then there are some stipulations in the policy before departments can save any money for their own use. The county's general fund balance must be at least 12%. It has to be at 12%. That is a benchmark that was set by the commissioners at the recommendation of staff. So in 12-13, we were above the 12% threshold. So we qualified to start having savings revert to county departments. Now, this program savings portion does not kick in at 100% fully until the general fund is at 15%. We were not at 15% in 2012-13, but we were above 12. So what happens is, right off the top, any savings the department had in that year, a quarter of it, 25%, goes straight to general fund. So you have the department, they have their savings based on the audit at the end of the year, 25% going to the general fund right off the top, because we were not at 15%. Had we been at a 15% fund balance, the department could possibly have kept all of its savings to use itself, but we were not. As we went through with the finance department and looked at what constitute departmental savings. There were some things that we left out and didn't feel like it would be a fair representation of departmental savings if we left them in. Designated funds, for example, some departments budget money every year to go into a designated fund. That's not a savings. It's not going to be spent. It's going to be given to the department in their budget. At the end of the year, it goes into a fund. But we don't count those. We have some funds like retiree insurance that are in certain budgets. We do not count any savings in those. So we had to go through and try to figure out what is applicable, what is not. Only county dollars are counted. So if a department had grant funds, if a department had donations, if a department had some other money coming from the outside, those do not count towards savings. Only county tax dollars budgeted for the department's operations can count. Also this year, revenue shortfalls were deducted from a department's savings. So if a department projected they were going to have $50,000 in revenue, that is not counting general fund monies, that's not, you know, property tax dollars, that might be fees. If the department fell short, $5,000. Those $5,000 shortfall was taken out of its savings. The idea would be to encourage departments to be as accurate as they can when they project their revenue for the year besides general fund tax dollars. And then also, when we looked at the department savings, the policy has a sliding scale for goal achievement. So as departments missed goals or were able to achieve goals, they started losing portions of their savings on down the line. So they had a scale of, you know, 90 to 100%, they got 100% all the way down. It's laid out in the policy. And then the final reduction that happened to some department savings, a department cannot retain more than 8% of its budget. So you can't have a department that bankrolls, you know, millions of dollars. There is a cap. Can't be more than 8%. Is there any questions about how the departments save their money or the difference between goal setting and non-goal setting? This page, I want to talk to you for just a moment about the total dollars saved by departments in 12-13. County departments, county government only, saved a total of a little over $2.6 million in 2012-13. That means they were allocated their starting balances. They went throughout the fiscal year. At the end of the fiscal year, based on the audit, $2.6 million was saved. That's how much they did not spend saved. After we applied all these things that I've talked to you about, we looked at their revenues, we looked at their designated funds, if they had any, how many goals did they achieve, those things. The savings bank for all departments totaled $1,177,178. That was the amount of money out of the $2.6 billion that departments will be able to bank to spend on other things, the items that are approved in the policy. So they didn't keep all that savings. $2.6 million was saved across all county government. $1.17 million is eligible to be used in this program. And that is about 3%. That total savings dollar is about 3% of what the county departments were budgeting. So $2.6 million is about 3%. And you can look on this page. There's a couple of samples of goals here that departments had and achievements that they made. Some of them have to do with savings. For example, the facilities department, they made it a goal that year to replace fluorescent lights across the county with a much better, higher technology type of lamp. They will create savings. It didn't happen in 12-13. It will happen over the life of those bulbs. If you know you got them at your house, you put them in over their life, they save a tremendous amount of money. So this was a goal that the facilities department did that will save money for the county, but it's not going to be realized in 12-13. And then you had some goals that departments set that were more either customer service or health and well-being. I think one mentioned here that I found to be outstanding was CCOM. They answered 96% of all 911 calls within 10 seconds. Well, that's the national average is 90. So our folks in our CCOM are tracking their progress, tracking the calls coming in. We're well ahead of the national average. So what I thought I would like to do is I'm going to just briefly go through the department pages. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on each one. If you have a question about a particular department, I'd be happy to try to answer it. But it's also important to remember that these goals and the achievements listed here are only a fraction of what the departments do throughout the year. These are just a few things. And again, this was their first year. So this is the first year we've looked at the savings, and this is the first year we've looked at goal results. So each department has a page. On that page, you'll see how much the department banked in savings. That is not how much they saved total, that is how much they banked. And then there's goal information there about the things the department picked out before the start of the year to try to accomplish and then accomplish. The facilities department had some excellent goals. And again, for them, their work order goals were very important. I think they had over 2,500 work orders in 12-13, and they were able to get the vast majority of them done by that five-day benchmark. And that's very good. That's all across county departments, county government. Our human resources department, one of their goals was to conduct background checks and drug screens on every employee that came in, which is critical for our departments to make sure the public can feel comfortable about the people that work for the county. That was accomplished. Cooperative extension, they saved the county money through their master gardener program. They tracked that dollar amount, that value. These were volunteer hours that were provided by the master gardeners. Some communications I mentioned earlier, being able to answer 911 calls at a very high percentage, in fact, better than the national average. Our Department of Social Services, one of the interesting goals from DSS, they did a fantastic job on their program integrity, basically making sure that fraud was caught and that people were prosecuted and money was recovered where possible. It's very valuable. It saves taxpayer dollars. It might be state or federal, but it also is a great deterrent to people that may be considering committing some level of fraud. EMS had some very good goals. One of them was to reduce the number of workers' comp claims, and they put a lot of emphasis in 12-13 working with their people to help them work safely, and they had a very good success. Our finance and purchasing department did a lot to reduce some internal costs by moving to some paper-saving measures and by getting an award of excellence for the audit. Our fire marshal's office was able to complete plan reviews very timely. Why is this important? If you're building a business and you're waiting for those plan reviews to be done, you need them done quickly because you don't want to pay equipment to be waiting around our folks to get our part of the job done. Our GIS folks, very similar. These fire marshal, GIS, these are all part of central permit. So they have a link together to try to get things done quickly. We've got to generate that address for that new business, that new piece of property. It's in the best financial interest of the business that we do that quickly. Health department had a lot of customer service type goals, trying to ensure that their clients at environmental health and the health department were satisfied with the service they received. County inspections, again, being able to guarantee that all inspections will be performed on the day they are scheduled. And they hit that goal, and that is a very good one to have. Again, that leads you, if you're waiting to have that inspection done, to get the equipment off-site, it's very important that county inspections and the fire marshal's office are able to move quickly to do it. The landfill is one department that's a little bit different than most county government. They're an enterprise fund. So a lot of the advantages that the performance management system brings to other county government, they already enjoy. If they have savings, it stays with them, and they're able to come before you and ask for those savings to be used to buy a piece of equipment or whatever. The one bonus thing that the landfill will see out of this policy is the ability to, if the department head chooses, allocate some funding for employee bonuses. And they did a fantastic job on their goals. Also, particularly doing PM of their equipment. Greg's up here a lot, and he's asking for new equipment to keep space, that premium space down there, everything crushed well. Well, I can tell you, they do a lot of work to keep it up and keep it maintained. They know the value of it. Our MIS department worked hard to try to limit the number of copiers and cut some costs there, as well as make sure work orders were addressed timely. Planning department, again, they're a part of central permitting, so they have a responsibility to address when they get plans in, turn them around quick, as well as they receive, as you all know, a tremendous number of calls and complaints about situations that arise out in the county, and so they try to get to those as quickly as they can. They set a five-day period to try to address them, and they were able to do that in less than 3 days on average. Recreation Parks Department, many of our goals involved user satisfaction. It's one thing for me to tell you that the budget for the Recreation Department will get you a baseball season, because it will, and you approve it. It's another thing for me to tell you that it was a good quality baseball season. That was our goal, so you don't just get the ball season. You get one that 80% of people enjoy them. I got to tell you, there's a winner and loser in every game. And so 80% was a pretty high goal, and we felt comfortable about it. Soil and water. Again, Soil to Soil and Water's goals was to outreach and try to promote out in the community how to conserve water. Our tax department had one of tax's goals in 12-13 was to take many of these historical maps, these older maps that are only available, having to come in this office and go down there and pull the old file out. They're quite brittle. They scanned almost 3,500 of those, which were all of them. They are now all available on DVD, and it's a huge help for attorneys, for real estate agents, and they have received numerous compliments about putting that information in a digital format. Veteran Services, one of their big goals was to try to address clients' needs on the first visit. You know, our veterans, some of them have a hard time getting out and about, and making a visit back to the office. They try to knock out as much as they could when they first got them. Our legal department set some internal goals, again, to save paper and cut costs on their operations, and they were able to do so. Board of Elections had goals that pertain to publicizing a lot of information like campaign finance reports, which I think people appreciate being able to see and access that information. Register of Deeds, this is similar to tax, one of the Register of Deeds' main goals was to try to digitize older records. People that are doing genealogy or research of deeds, they wanted to, births, they've been able to digitize a great deal of older documents. Sheriff's Office. The Sheriff's Office did a fantastic job ensuring that a high percentage of civil papers are served. If you have a tenant and your tenant is not paying rent and you file papers on that tenant, you want that served quickly, because the longer that person stays in your apartment or house, they are costing you money. So there is a real incentive for you, for the Sheriff's Office, to serve those papers quickly, which they do. They also set a goal to meet or exceed the state clearance rate in four of the seven crime areas, which I noted what those were for that year. Bear with me for just one moment. I think it's worth mentioning. The Sheriff's Department exceeded the state clearance rate for aggravated assault, burglary, larceny, and motor vehicle theft, and that's very good. And the library. Library took a big stand on customer service and required set a goal for all staff participate in customer service training, which they did, and they also made significant use of their self-service stations in Graham and May Memorial. They had a goal of 25% of all checkout transactions being handled by self-service, and they achieved a goal of over a little over half were handled by self-checkout. So it's kind of an idea of the goals of the departments from 12 and 13. Also, the savings, approximately $1.1 million, would be able to be spent by departments. I want to make sure you guys understand that when the departments want to spend this money, they will have to come to you. They'll go to the county manager with a list of the different things based on that policy that they want to do. Maybe they want to buy a new vehicle. If that's what they want to do with their money, they give that to Mr. Honeycutt. It will be presented to you for final approval. So you will still have the ability to approve any expenditures that the departments want to do with their savings. And just briefly tell you where we are with the upcoming fiscal year. We're wrapping up 13-14 now. I'll be reporting this again to you next year about how 2013-14 finished out. And we're in the process right now of developing goals. We kept pretty close to the same goals, 12-13, 13-14. This year, for 14-15, we've established a committee of people that have had some experience in this program, some of the original pilot departments, county management. Everyone has to have their goals into the county manager's office by June the 20th. They will be reviewed by this committee, then meet back with the department heads, talk about those goals, and then on the July 21st meeting, I will bring each one of you a list of all county department goals. So you will have the opportunity to review them all right at the start of the fiscal year. You can comment on them, however you like, but at least you'll be aware of them and know what's going on. I believe that is all that I have to present about the goals for the department. So is there any questions? There's no action necessitated at this point. We know what the savings were. We know how they fell out based on the policy. At this point, we're prepared to assign them their dollar amounts, start receiving spending plans from them, which we will bring to you.
Any comments, Tim? You were able to get this project, which turned out fantastic, I think.
Well, I think it's turned out better than county management at first thought it would, not Brian and not Craig. But I remember Burgess just plain as day standing here telling us that we probably wouldn't experience much because of that we had already cut to the bone as it was. And I don't mean to be negative. I don't think that's negative. I'm just stating fact. And I think it's obvious that there was more that we could do. And so I'm proud of where it wound up. How many counties are doing this?
Not very many counties. It's popular in cities. And in fact, there is a benchmarking project through the UNC School of Government for cities. So only a handful. I think Pitt County is one. And we're using some of their goals as some examples for our departments now. We kind of looked at theirs. They have some very good goals, similar departments to Alamance County. Davidson, of course. Off the top of my head, I'm not sure of any others.
Rockingham.
Cities do utilize this program. And again, you can look at School of Government and they monitor. They have it's almost like a group you can join if you're a city, and they share information. So if, let's say in recreation, city recreation, if a baseball satisfaction is a common goal, then you can compare your results to all the other cities that are participating. That's really pretty powerful, because if I tell you that 89% of the people playing baseball with Alamance County are enjoying it, think it's great, that's very good. But how does that stack up with other cities? You know, we may be ahead or behind.
I've brought this up before, and I still think it's worthy of looking at. You know, we, in a way, get involved by setting the budget or setting the tax rates. County management approves an overall budget. But I still think that management needs to get involved with the departments to look at goals and to say, well, no, you can do better than that. I mean, business does it all the time. When you sit back and are able to set your own goals, it's human nature, at least where I've ever been, that you don't really go for the gold. I remember when I was at the bank, the mortgage department set a goal for X amount of millions of dollars in home loans. The president asked me, he said, well, what do you think? And I said, well, I know what I'm doing, and I think their goal should be double, frankly. And he got back in there, and he doubled their goal. And guess what? They made it. They made it. But
that's an excellent point. And in mm-hmm. fact, this year, as we said, we've set up this committee, including management, to look at departments' goals. One thing we're recommending departments do is they need to talk to a group that makes use of their service. So if you're like recreation, we want to talk with the Recreation Parks Commission, not just set them ourselves internally, but solicit input from them. Uh-huh. It's also a good idea for departments of county government that are internal service. It's good for them to ask the departments that they work for or with, uh-huh. what can we do to better serve you? And that's the plan for this upcoming year. And again, once the 21st, I'll be back in front of you with that comprehensive list, and you'll be able to see what the departments are planning to do in 14-15. Because you're right, the departments, you approve their budget and give them that financial means mm-hmm. to give you deliverables, mm-hmm. basically. Then these goals help them do that or make sure that they're quality.
Any other comments?
It's got to help morale. I think Mr. Honeycutt, it should make yours, Mr. Haga's job easier.
It does, and again, our departments have embraced it, and I appreciate the exemplary effort that Brian and Susan Roberts and Tom has done to get us to this point. But it we do now have buy-in from our departments, and I think part of it was when our fund balance was low and we did not have the flexibility, they're like, well, why do it? But now that we're on better financial standing, they understand that the savings can revert back to them and that there's things in the budget that they can plan for. And again, they don't have to spend all their money this year. If there's something major that they want to purchase, they can do this over multiple year budgets. But the money will be there. And again, we appreciate the board's direction. And I think we're on firm footing now, and again, it's a lagging process. You know, this is 12-13 final report, and we're fixing to go into 14-15. So we're always a little bit behind because of the audit. However, as Brian said, I think it was a wonderful chance to change how we did our goals, reevaluate our goals, and really also to get the board involved in the goal setting process.
Thank you, Brian.
Yes, sir.
You have the next item, too.
I do. I'm here this morning to also request that the board consider allowing our county to spend funds from the Capital Reserve Fund. I've had to add one project to this list. The information I gave you dealt with two projects. There are a total of three. We had an incident occur that we're hoping to use some of these funds to address. I wasn't able to get it into the backup. The three projects that we're asking you to consider allowing us to fund with Capital Reserve money. First is a emergency repairs that had to be done at the Alamance County Jail. The dollar amount was $11,083.69. These were pipes that broke in the ceiling of the jail, sewage plumbing pipes.
Yes,
it's over some of the administrative offices, made a terrible mess. It was, that work has been done. It had to be done. What we're hoping to do is get you to approve us taking the funding for that work from Capital Reserve. The second project that we have that I put in my information to you is a request to spend $3,864. This is less than the normal $10,000 limit. Usually these funds have a $10,000 amount that we try not to come up here with anything less. However, this is a timing issue. We own property at 1212 Turrentine Street that was formerly part of mental health. And currently the tenant is Ralph Scott Life Services. They use it for Starpoint daytime activities for seniors with disabilities. And the county owns the building, but Ralph Scott uses it and is responsible for all of its maintenance and upkeep. The building is in poor shape. And what we would hope you would entertain is at some point we're able to transfer ownership of the building to Ralph Scott. The county currently owns it. We're interested in getting Ralph Scott to be the owner. I think this would probably be similar to what was done with OE right. Enterprises. They need repair work done. We've talked with the city of Burlington. Ralph Scott would qualify for low interest loans, for various grants, if they were the owner of the building, then they would be able to get those funds. In order to make that happen, there is on the property, apparently there used to be some type of automotive repair part of the mental health program on this property. There are fuel pump, above ground fuel pumps, some lines that are in the ground. There was an underground storage tank. It has been removed back in the 90s, according to Diener's requirements. But Ralph Scott has asked that we would remove those pumps and those lines and get those out of there before we get into the trying to get ownership of them. Main reason is some of the funds that they and the assistance they would be going for is federal, and the federal government will require that those will be gone. So they want us to do that. We believe we can do that for the $3,864. That would take care of it. And the reason I'm bringing this to you now is because we need to go ahead and get it done. Because if we're able to transfer ownership to Ralph Scott, however, whatever mechanism we use, the next round of funding that Ralph Scott could qualify for would be in the fall. So if we can go ahead and get this done now, get the process underway to try to get them to be owners of the building, hopefully this fall they would be able to apply for funding to fix primarily the roof. The roof is the number one problem. And we did get three bids on that project, and Southern Logistics Environmental is the low bid. Then the last project that has come up in the past couple of days, we had a compressor to fail on the chiller over at Criminal Courts. We have a request here for $10,996 to make that repair. We'll be using Comfort Systems USA Mid-Atlantic. They were the lowest of three bidders also. We want to go ahead and get that work done quickly. I think court is out of session this week. So if we can roll on it now, we can get in there without interrupting their case schedules and get it done. We need to do it also before it gets up into the 90s regularly so we keep the building cool for them. The balance of capital reserve at this time is $59,256.88. That's how much we have in the fund. If you approve all three of these projects, the new balance will be $33,313.19. So we'll still have some funding available in there, which will roll over to next fiscal year. So I'll be happy to try to answer any questions about these projects.
Any questions from the board? Do we have a motion?
Ralph Scott, that's the halftime school. Is that what it used to be?
It's
a different location.
That parcel, there are two buildings on that parcel. One is up on Stokes Street at the corner of Stokes and Turrentine. I think that might be the Happy House.
Right.
This is a very large building down further down Turrentine.
Just so you guys know, Happy Time was a school for challenged children and really did a good job. But that's
that building is also county-owned and is also on the property. We are also working with that property owner to try to figure out, can we get that entity become the owner? You know, what we're trying to do is limit the county's exposure on all these buildings if we're not actually using them. If there's an entity in there that can do it, we want to work with that entity to become the owner of the building. So that will be another one we'll be working on.
And as Brian said, most of those buildings are going to require major, major upgrades and repairs, and we're just not in the position to do that. And again, we're not charging rent on those buildings. So it's just been kind of a gratis thing that they've been responsible, but they have a better opportunity to receive funding if they're the owners instead of the county.
I'd move that we accept the request.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
I am always riding Brian Haygood because his dad and I serve on the board of directors of our condo complex, and it seems like every time I turn around, I'm running into a Haygood. But I have to tell a story. When I was county manager, I offered the job of assistant county manager to Brian Haygood, and he turned me down. That's the kind of young man he is. And knowing his dad, I know why, because it's a fine family. And you may not know, but Brian is a combat veteran of the Marine Corps, and we thank you for your service, Brian. Mr. Manager, County Line.
I wish I had something to report. The county attorney and I met with Guilford County to discuss their action of not approving the resolution for the petitions. We asked for them to send us back their response about where they're at, what they would like to see going as we move forward. But we still have nothing formally from them at this time. So we were kind of putting the ball back in their court. If they made the decision not to approve the petition, what direction would they like to see us go? And so we're still waiting on that response at this point.
Well, I thought they made it clear.
We've never gotten anything.
No. They said they were not going to go with the zigzag line, number one. Number two, their county manager, I saw the email, said that they suggested that y'all get together and figure out how to tax the people in the counties. I read it. So where are we off?
We have asked in what direction and what time frame. Is there another local bill that has to be done? Or we are approving the geodetic, but there's nothing formal that we have gotten from them at this point.
Well, what was his email said, we need to get together and figure out how we're going to tax everybody. Now, that looks pretty definitive to me. They're saying they're not going to go with the zigzag line. Thank God somebody got their senses. And to me, it's a dead issue. We ought to just go ahead and get our tax people with their people and us go ahead and vote to accept the geodetic line. I move that we say that we're going to adopt the geodetic line. Defeated is defeated. We should have done it back when their board said they weren't going to go with anything but the geodetic line. And then you got a new board in and Mickey moused around with that. And now they finally have come back. They've made it clear. Geodetic. And county manager wrote and said, come over here, we need to get together and work out how we're going to tax. I mean, what else needs to be said?
If I may add one thing, Mr. Sutton, we were hoping to get a decision from them before the legislature went out of session. Since the local bill that we had was still alive at the time, we were hoping to get a decision from them so we could go back to our legislative delegation and do whatever they decided to do and this board decided to do. That's the timing issue, and we just simply ran out of time.
Well, to insinuate that things would have been different had you had more time, I don't think
I'm just saying that before the whatever line the board chooses, geodetic, whatever line, you have to go to the legislature because the General Assembly has to pass a law adopting that line. And that's the timing issue, we just ran out of time. The May 15th deadline came and went.
Well, people need to know how they're going to be taxed, even if the technicality of whether you're going to go with geodetic or not is approved in Raleigh now or 6 months from now. But again, I support the geodetic. I think most sane people do. I'm sorry. Two states are accepting geodetic. There was really never any precedence out there to zigzag a line. And they have made it clear they're not going to zigzag their line. And I don't know what else you have to hear from. As far as that, I think if you tell them, okay, we agree with you, we'll go with geodetic, that at that point they'll finally start moving the wheels to do what has to be done to decide how to tax the people. It's not a hard deal. We're making it hard. We've made it hard for over a year. We opened Pandora's box, and it just seems to stay open, and nobody's got guts enough to shut it. But again, I move that we accept geodetic.
I'd like to just remind everybody that Mr. Albright is correct. The legislature will have to approve or not approve this. So it's really, we've got plenty of time. It's next year before anything can happen in Raleigh, first off. Secondly, we sat here and listened to more than 20 people ask for their petitions and so forth, and we as a board voted 4-1 to approve those petitions. Guilford County previously agreed to approve those petitions before they changed their minds again. So they're kind of wishy-washy on the issue starters, and that board's going to change. Talking about the Guilford County, and for that matter, the Alamance County board's going to change after November. I would suggest that we just sit on this issue temporarily and see what happens in November and let the new boards take a position. I just think it's unfair to the citizens that we go with a straight line when a lot of people are going to be adversely affected otherwise.
I agree with John. I think those folks came in here and told us they want to be in Alamance County. They thought they were in Alamance County. It was not their fault that they're not in Alamance County, and I certainly support them. I want them to be in Alamance County. That board in Guilford County has changed their minds 2 or 3 times, and I don't see us making any statement whatsoever at this time until after the election, at least, because depending on who they put on their board up there, they could change their mind again. And I'm sick and tired of this issue. It's been going on, 6, 7, 8 years?
Tim Sutton didn't belabor it. I'll assure you that.
So I agree with John on that. I don't know how the rest of the board feels, but I think it ought to be tabled until at least after the election in November.
I agree.
Well, that's fine. Y'all go ahead.
Well, there's a motion on the floor. Yeah. Is there a second to
Tim? I'm not through talking about it. I would say that we, in my 20 years on this board, and I am glad it's finally coming to an end. I have other things I want to do, and I'm going to do them, and I've already started doing them. But I have never seen such an unprofessional, Mickey Mouse, wishy-washy, lack of backbone effort in county government that we started when we opened Pandora's box on the Orange County side, and now we're wanting to hope for a different election so that you can win, or somebody can win, rather than handle it while it's on your platter now. But I'm not surprised. But it beats all I've ever seen. You got no precedence out there that zigzagging the line is the way to handle it. You have people in states, the North and South Carolina, they're saying geodetic is it. We're sorry if you think you live in South Carolina, you now live in North Carolina. You got to get North Carolina's license, and we're going to grandfather in everything that you had, schools and so forth and so on. But I've never seen anything to beat it, frankly. And I don't think I'm that irrational about it. I'll tell you what. Go ahead, we'll vote it down. That's fine. But I'll take the precedents that are in my favor any day of the week. I have states. I have geodetic surveyors, and there's a lack of precedence out there showing that moving a line is the way to handle it. And to think that we're the only county that has this issue is naive. It's naive. Everybody in the state's got these same issues, but they don't move the D line. But all right, I'm sorry.
Wait a minute, there's a motion on the floor. There has not been a second. Is there a second to Tim's motion? Hearing no second, the motion fails. Is there a new motion? I'll make a motion that we table this matter until after the election in November.
I'll second that motion.
Any discussion on that?
Mickey Mouse.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Motion passes 3-1. Finance Officer Tom.
Aren't we having fun?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. One item to bring to the board's attention. As everyone remembers, 2 weeks ago we passed our budget for 2014-2015. That budget included a provision in the funding for the schools that 0.5% supplement increase would be included in the money that was coming from the Board of Commissioners. Since that time, there's been some question on the part of certain school board members whether or not the commission has the right to what they term line item manage their budget. In other words, if we include the allocation for the amount of the 0.5%, which is roughly $428,000, are they obligated to use that for the teacher supplement? And the answer is, under state statute 115C.429, the Board of County Commissioners is allowed to allocate part or all of its appropriation by purpose, function, or project as defined in uniform budget format. And there are certain purpose codes, one of which is called Code 5000, which is instructional services. It includes the cost of activities dealing directly with the interaction between teachers and students. That would fall under the inclusion of local supplement pay to teachers. The reason I'm here before you now is to request that we offer a budget amendment that would clarify that information for the school board as they finalize their budget. A small change to what our original disclosure was in our budget ordinance to read as follows. Appropriation of $428,000 shall be made payable to the Alamance Burlington School Systems Fund 2, Purpose Code 5000-Instructional Services, to fund a 0.5% increase to the teacher supplement from 8.5% to 9%. The commissioners agree and approve this budget amendment and can sign it now or after the meeting. We'll make sure the schools get a copy of it before their meeting tonight.
Do you need a motion?
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Second. Any discussion on that? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Mr. Manager.
No updates at this time. Again, I do want to thank Ryan and our department heads and finance for the wonderful job that they did on the outdoor space managing and their leadership. And we're looking forward to the goals, and we'll bring them back at our next meeting. So thank you.
I would also like to thank the staff for the great job they did on the performance management based budgeting. I think it's a grand job, and really proud of department heads and their staff. Any other comments from commissioners? Hearing none, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.